The biggest advantage of Kubernetes is that it can abstract away individual servers for you. Now, you don't need to worry about specific details of individual servers. Instead, Kubernetes collects all the details of each node, such as memory, CPU, and other stuff. Plus, it has a built-in scheduler that can decide where to put your workloads. Let's go over a simple example of how the scheduler selects a node. For instance, you have a pod that requires 2 CPUs and 4 GB of memory. The first step for the scheduler is to filter out all nodes that do not meet the criteria, perhaps because they don't have enough resources. The remaining nodes are called feasible nodes. Now, the next step is for Kubernetes scheduler to run a set of functions to score the feasible nodes. It then selects a node with the highest score among the feasible ones to run the pod. If you get multiple feasible nodes with the same score, the scheduler will randomly select one. This process is called binding. Now, in the real world, you may have a bunch of different nodes in your Kubernetes cluster. Maybe you have Windows nodes, nodes with high CPU for running CPU-intensive tasks, or memory-optimized nodes. In the cloud, it's common to have spot nodes that are cheaper but can be terminated at any time. So your app must be capable of recovering quickly. Some nodes may use AMD64 architecture while others use ARM, such as Graviton nodes. These are again cheaper, but your application must be compiled to run on ARM first. You might also have GPU nodes to run machine learning pipelines. Other nodes may have fast SSD disks attached locally. For example, if you decide to run Kafka in Kubernetes, you would definitely want fast local SSDs to improve performance, and so on. With all these different types of servers, the default scheduler cannot always decide the best place to run your pods. So you'll need to give Kubernetes some extra instructions to help it make a better decision. Now, all recommended approaches use label selectors. No matter which option you decide to use, first you need to assign specific labels to your nodes. If you run kubectl get nodes show labels, you'll see some default well-known labels already attached to the nodes. In this case, we have a minikube setup with 3 nodes. You can attach labels manually, for example, using kubectl command as shown. However, in practice, we assign labels to node groups, not individual nodes, using Terraform or other automation tools. So in this example, we have a node or a set of nodes with SSD local disks attached to them. We want to create a deployment or any other object such as stateful set, job, etc. and run it only on that node with the label disk type equal to SSD. The simplest and oldest approach is to use node selector. Although it's very powerful approach, it's not very flexible. This will instruct this deployment to deploy all the pods on nodes with our label. You can test it using minikube. It should be running on the 3rd node. Again, node selector is the simplest way to bind specific pods to the nodes. A more advanced approach would be to use affinity, and we'll start with node affinity. This does the same thing as node selector, but it's much more flexible. It can also be used with all Kubernetes objects, such as deployments, stateful sets, etc. Let's say we have 3 nodes. The first one only has well-known labels. The second has additional price label equal to spot. And the third one has the same label from the previous example, disk type equal to SSD. First, let's convert the previous node selector to node affinity. This is how the whole deployment will look like. For now, let's only consider the affinity section. Right after specifying affinity, we state the type. In this case, we want to bind the pod to the node. We'll talk about pod affinity later. Node affinity has 2 types: required during scheduling and preferred. You might also notice ignored during execution. This means that if the pod has already been scheduled to a particular node and is running, and only after that you updated or removed the node label, it will be ignored and the pod will still be running on the same node. So this section is only considered during the pod scheduling step. Next, we have node selectors. As you can see, we have arrays in multiple places, and we'll discuss them as well. But for now, the key is the label name, and the value is the label's value. This is exactly the same as node selector, but much more verbose. In this case, Kubernetes will schedule this pod on the third node with the appropriate label. You can also use multiple values for the same label. In this case, it's OR operation, so at least one label must be present on the node. Thus, in this situation, the pod will still be scheduled on the third node. Now, let's talk about operators. Here is a full list of operators you can use in your affinity section. Some of them apply only to node affinity. In the next example, we use two conditions with two different labels. Again, only one of these labels must be present on the node. It can be price on demand or disk type equal to SSD. In this case, the pod will also be scheduled on the third node. However, in this example, when we specify multiple conditions under match expressions, all of them must be present on the node. So, since node 3 does not have both labels, this pod will be stuck in pending state. All the examples are in my GitHub repo, and you can use it with Minikube to test these conditions. Another useful feature about node affinity is that you can set up soft constraints. It's called preferred during scheduling. In this case, Kubernetes will try to schedule it on the third node, but if for some reason, perhaps insufficient resources, it fails, Kubernetes will place it on other nodes. So Kubernetes won't leave this pod in a pending state. In the final example, we use the wait attribute. It's self-explanatory. If the label exists with a high weight, such as price equal to spot, the Kubernetes scheduler during the calculation of the score for feasible nodes will add this value and place the pod on the second node. In general, this is my default approach to constrain pods. Now, you can also schedule pods based on other pod labels. For example, you might want to collocate some pods or distribute them across many different nodes. In my opinion, the best way to learn is to provide more examples and explain the behavior. But first, all nodes must have the same topology key. It's a label key, such as Kubernetes.io hostname. This key, not the value, must be the same on all nodes. Otherwise, the behavior of the pod affinity may be unpredictable. One of the most common use cases for pod affinity is to use anti-affinity and deploy the pods on different nodes. In this case, if one Kubernetes node goes down or is being upgraded, the impact is minimal. This pod anti-affinity is frequently used to deploy Nginx and other ingress controllers, where it's very important to have as many of them running simultaneously because of the load. The syntax is very similar to node affinity, and you also have required and preferred options, which define soft constraints. In this example, when we create a deployment object, we use pod labels as a constraint and specify the topology key. But be careful if you're using required during scheduling. If you don't have enough Kubernetes nodes, pods will be stuck in pending state. In the following example, we use preferred scheduling. Now, if we deploy three pods, they will all be equally distributed across all nodes. But if we add more pods than we have nodes, they will still be scheduled as well. It's not recommended to use it on large Kubernetes clusters with more than a couple of hundred nodes, because it's a compute-intensive task for the scheduler. But I still use it, especially for critical workloads that cannot be down. In the last example, we use pod affinity to collocate some pods on the same nodes. The reason for this is to reduce latency if different pods need to communicate with each other. One of the examples from the open source Helm chart would be to place Kafka and Zookeeper on the same node, since they need to interact and the lower latency is better. Also, keep in mind that by default, these constraints only apply to the namespace where you deploy the application. Now, with anti-affinity or affinity, if you want to create constraints not only within a single deployment and a namespace, you need to add a namespace selector. This empty object will update the behavior of the affinity to look for all namespaces. And finally, let's talk about taints and tolerations. Taints are used to repel pods. For example, you might have multiple instance groups in your cluster, such as spot nodes and perhaps GPU nodes. If you don't use Affinity to schedule pods or use preferred soft constraints, you wouldn't want to accidentally schedule pods on those node groups. For this, you use Taints. You can set them manually, but of course, in the cloud, we use Terraform to set constraints on node groups. When you have a taint, in order to schedule pods on those nodes, you need to add toleration section in your deployment or any other object. You can use describe command to check the taint key and the value on the node. I think the most common example of taints would be Kubernetes control plane. By default, Kubernetes adds some taints that prevent you from scheduling pods on the master nodes. However, it doesn't apply to Minikube. Sometimes you might want to deploy logging or monitoring agents such as FluentBit on all nodes with all possible taints. You can use this syntax to tolerate all of them. You can use Affinity and Tolerations together, or just pick one of them. If you want to learn more about networking, you can watch this video explaining how to expose application from Kubernetes, or another one which describes the differences between deployment, stateful set, and daemon set. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.